an impression of who we are as a people, especially when we go into work. That the people who are supposed to be our best ambassadors are many times misrepresenting us when they go out. That it takes really just one experience and one encounter with a Nigerian in Leeds for someone in the United Kingdom to have a perspective of 170 million people in Nigeria. But most of the people who come are really just individuals. They don't realize that they are representing a people. They were not given any certificate of accreditation saying that you are an ambassador to this nation. So when they were leaving, they just left Nigeria thinking that they were just a human being or just a citizen. And whatever it was that they were doing, not one of them thought that a whole nation was going to be branded by their actions. You see, on that day, it became clear to me, a very simple thing I want to share with you, that individual success is nothing in the face of collective failure. That regardless of how well I have worked hard to position myself, how well I have become known or famous or regarded or wealthy, it doesn't make a difference. As long as we as a people collectively have failed to actualize our destiny and our potential as a people. It occurred to me that my individual effort and success will amount to nothing. It occurred to me that you will always be judged by where you came from, regardless of what passport you carry. You see, carrying any other passport apart from your passport of origin, someone will always ask, where did you come from, not where are you? You see, the passport that you have today, especially for those of you who have, you know, either the privilege or have struggled or have worked it to get another passport, whatever it is, that passport doesn't say where you're from, it says where you are. But you know, it's amazing that even when people can find out that this is where you are, they still want to know where you're from. In other words, those people can see the fruits, they want to know the seeds that produce it. And ultimately, every time they ask you, you will say, well, I'm from the United Kingdom, maybe. And they'll say, yeah. So if you don't get this, where are your parents from? Now, that is a different question, but they want to know. And sometimes you might just say, well, what business is that of yours? And then they'll say to you, are you not proud of your heritage? Because listen, they know the people who are from here. And you don't look listen, I understand that your hair looks like it. I understand that your nails look like it. I understand that your heart feels like it. But you don't look like it. And so your looks will always give you away, and people will always want to know your heritage. And as long as, listen to this, as long as wherever you are from is not reflective and is not commensurate to whatever you carry, they will judge what you carry, your passport, in the light of where you're from. And so a few weeks ago, I was listening to the news in the US, and a gentleman, an American citizen, had tried to use an expired boarding pass to board a plane. An American citizen of Nigerian descent. Now you need to understand, this is the big idea. When they said it, I thought to myself, listen, they said an American citizen of Nigerian descent had tried to use an expired boarding pass. Why did they have to put of Nigerian descent? Because they wanted you to know that that behavior was not an American behavior. At least so they wanted to project. So they would not say to you, if he had won the Olympic gold medal for long jump, that this is a British citizen
of Jamaican descent.
They don't say things like that to people like that, okay? They say you are of a different descent when you have not behaved decently in their own. Does anybody understand that?
Yes.
So let me bring it home for you. We can feel that we are away from all the problems and all the challenges. We can even think that we have the benefit and the privilege of not only going to school here, and you know, whatever is happening back home, well, that's their own issue. But it will happen to us. You know, I found out that when people from a less developed nation go to a more developed nation, they're called immigrants. When people from a more developed nation come to a less developed nation, they're called expatriates. So you have to understand that there is something about your background that must align with your future. That you cannot disintegrate completely from this place. Now listen to this. Each and every one of you was granted the privilege to be able to come here to receive a different kind of thinking so that the level and the quality of your thinking will supersede the level and the quality of the thinking that produced the problems in the place where your privilege came from. There's not one of you here who, either through the privilege that was given to your parents by Nigeria, or the privilege that was given straight from Nigeria to you in a way, not one of you can have been here if Nigeria had not blessed you. True or false? Now, I don't think that you were blessed just so that you could be blessed. I think that you were blessed so that you could become a blessing. This is what I think. I think that you become empowered to empower others. You become enlightened to enlighten others. I don't know whether you understand what I'm trying to say. It's extremely important that we get this right. I just want this. This is not even my talk. This is just the framework of the thinking that I need you to have. Because time has come. This is the framework. Listen to this. Ordinary citizens of great nations will always be treated better than the most successful citizens of failed countries. If you need me to say that again, I will. Ordinary citizens of great nations will always be treated better than even successful, privileged citizens of failed nations. So how do nations become great? Let us be clear. Nations are not defined or built by borders or boundaries. Nations are not based on buildings and bridges. Nations are built by a collection of people, many of whom may have different and diverse backgrounds. And when those people can share a common set of values and share a vision and say, this is where we're going together. When they can share a common dream and they can decide to live for that dream, then they have become a nation. So a nation will always have people of diverse backgrounds, but they will have people of a common purpose, a common vision, and a common set of values. Can somebody please say with me, common purpose,
common purpose.
Common vision,
common vision,
and common set of values.
Set of values.
This is what will forever build nations. The day that they no longer see the same place where they're going together, they are no longer a nation. Then they no longer have the same vision, they have become a nation in division. The day that they no longer have the same set of core values, they have become disintegrated, because your values are the things that teach you what is right from what is wrong, what is good from what is bad, what is acceptable from what is unacceptable. In fact, if your values are really strong, they will define for you what is possible and what is impossible. Because if anybody says to you to do this and it violates your values, if your values are strong, you'll say it is impossible for me to do so.
Now, regardless of where you're from, once we have the same set of values, then we both think the same thing as right. Does that make sense? We both think the same thing as wrong. Does that make sense? We both define the same thing as good and commendable. We both describe the same thing as despicable. Which means that I will not do something that will violate you, not because of you, but because of me. Does that make sense? And regardless of where we are from, once we have the same set of shared values, then we have become brother and sister. We have become alike. It is not our language or tribe or tongue, it is the decision-making factor that makes us united. And today we may not look like a great nation, but I want you to understand that this is the way that great nations are built. Great nations are built when the people of privilege decide to take their success and sacrifice it at the altar of greatness. In other words, they are going to say, why should I bother to come when I have a client that I have to say no to be here? If I had done what my business required of me, I would have earned more money this weekend. But you know what? It's not about how much I can earn. It's what it is that I can do to make sure that my children, your children, can have a great nation where they bring out their passport and the people that receive that passport say, oh my God, you're Nigerian? Oh my God, it's good to meet you. Now, you may or may not believe that that day is coming, but I can tell you that it is. Now, I'm not here to tell you because, oh, Fela is here to encourage you. I know what we're doing to make it happen. Why? Because there are a group of people who have accepted that our generation is empowered, we are motivated, we are stirred, and we are stirred to operate with natural excellence. There is a group of people who have turned their back on mediocrity and all the things that have marked us as a people. There are a group of people who have decided that it is our own God-given right and responsibility to make and transform our nation into a most desirable nation. There are a group of people who have said that it is not who started the problem that matters, it is who solves the problem. That is the person that history remembers. There are a group of people who have said to ourselves, we will accept responsibility. We own this nation, it is our nation. It is not their nation, therefore I cannot blame them, they or their, for the problems that we have. We accept responsibility for the problems, whether we started it or not, but we will solve this problem. And because I know that that group is growing by the day, by the second, I know that we have a set of values today that I will be glad to share with you tomorrow, if you can. That I know that we have a vision for a nation, a new nation, and today we have 11 years, 2 months, and 28 days to go. And every day we are counting. Time is valuable to us. We work with time, we keep time, we do things on time. We're not different. We are the new example of a new Nigeria. And so, basically, I want you to know that my faith in Nigeria does not come just because I know that God said so, because God did say so.
Yeah.
On November 23, 2004, I had an encounter. And whether you believe in God or don't believe in God, that's not why I'm here. But I had an encounter that I believe was in the presence of God. And he asked me a question. And the question was very simple. He said to me, what will happen if I were to give this nation a noble cause? Something that is greater than every single one person. Something that basically is worthy of dying for because it will continue to live after you have left. And if every single person were to get a cause that is bigger than them, that they can plug their life into, a beautiful jigsaw puzzle that their piece makes a very critical part to that jigsaw puzzle. And I said, wow, that's interesting. And he said, what if I gave all your leaders good guidance? He said to me, would you have corruption in the land? I said, no. He said, would you have failed businesses? I said, no. He said, would you have children born outside wedlock? I said, of course not. He said, what if I gave every young person the ability to know the truth about who they are, what they carry, what they bring to the table, why they're on earth, and what they have the ability to make happen? I said, wow. He said to me, will we have area boards? I said, no. Will we have our batteries? I said, never. He said, what if we could, every one of the people could live in love? He said, will the Modakekes and Ifes fight? I said, no. He said, will the Ijaws and Shakiris kill each other? I said, absolutely not. He said, will there be a religious crisis? I said, no, no. He said, what if everyone lived just and true? And I heard a voice in my head say, where the people are just, you don't need judges. And where the people speak truth, there will be no need for people to go and settle matters. He said, what if everybody could aspire for great and lofty heights and not just mere success? Because success is about income, greatness is about impact. Successful people seek and crave respect, but honor comes naturally to the great. Successful people want to be famous, but prominence is what has greatness all over. Great. Successful people are looking for promotion. They want to make sure that they become influential. They want to become affluential. But don't you understand that prominence gives you prominence that nobody can take away from you? Successful people are driven by the desire for prosperity, but great people think about posterity. He said, what if? What if? What if? I gave the people a heart for greatness. And they all pursued greatness, not just success. Ladies and gentlemen, please permit me to just stop at this point and give you an example. There was, and there is, because I believe the man is not yet dead, a gentleman in the city of Potapa. And it is said concerning this gentleman that his house is so big and so beautiful and so luxuriant that even the gravel from his gate to his pathway, to his doorway. You know how most people have gravel?
Yeah.
His own is crushed marble. Crushed marble. He has two 420 kVA generators. Maybe you don't understand. A 420 kVA generator will probably almost power a street. He's got two of them. And this gentleman was complaining about how much he had spent on diesel and saying that he had spent more money on diesel than the bloody transformer that NEPA refused to change. It is also said concerning this gentleman that where he built his house, the road to it has no drainages. So in a sense, because it rains almost 7 months or 8 months in Port Harcourt, some of you know that, right? The road to his house is so bad that only jeeps can pass that road. And that's why the gentleman has only jeeps. But many of his neighbors have to park on adjacent streets and walk home because the roads are very bad. Now, would you call that man a successful man?
No.
Well, I would. I believe he has done well for himself. I believe he has mastered the art of earning income, however he has done so. But is he a great man?
No.
Okay. That we have in common, we agree. He is a man who has pursued success, but has not pursued greatness. He has earned an income, but has not made an impact on even his own immediate community. Does somebody understand where I'm coming from?
Yes.
Now, what I believe that God was saying to us was, what if I make everyone think more about the impact they create? And I'm not saying that's to the detriment of income, but I'm saying that you make an income because you're making an impact. What if, as a nation, we could all have peace and justice in our land. So that today, teachers are not on strike, doctors are not on strike, students are not on strike, the police are not trying to strike, army is not being court-martialed for mutiny. What if that happened? Anybody, can you give me an idea what will happen if that kind of thing would exist? Is anybody? What would happen to a nation if God were to give that kind of thing?
The nation itself would be great.
Eh?
The nation itself.
The nation itself would be great. Anybody else? So we're almost done now. It would be a sought-after nation. Would that be a desirable nation to live in?
Yes.
Would that possibly be one of the most desirable nations to live in?
Yes.
Well, at that point in time, please note, I thought that it would be such a great nation, I said it will be heaven on earth. So he asked me a question, do you recognize that prayer? And I said, what prayer? He said, do you know that if I say, oh God of creation, I'm praying to someone? I said, yes. He said, do you recognize it? And it was at that moment I thought to myself, oh, it's the second stanza of our national anthem. In a sense, we have legislated into law and formed into our constitution the ability to have a prayer that if God answered that prayer, we could have as the most desirable nation. Cut the long story short, I heard him say, write this down, and I picked up my pen and I wrote it. It was 10 minutes past 2 p.m. on November 23, 2004. And he said, write this down, that by December 31, 2025, Nigeria will be, undoubtedly, the world's most desirable nation to be. So I said, amen. And you need to understand why I said so. If you knew what I knew at that time, maybe you would not laugh at me, you would probably laugh with me. But you see, at that point in time, the statistics are there to show us that the movement for the emancipation of the Niger Delta declared that they were no longer going to be an agitation group, they were becoming a militant group. It was in 2004 that we had the first experience of blown up pipelines, and we started to see the kidnapping of expatriates because they had been told to leave the oil-producing regions of the South-South. And they said they were no longer safe. This was what they had to do. It was in that same 2004 that the movement for the actualization of the sovereign state of Biafra had issued the Biafran pound, and even though the central bank governor of Nigeria had said that it was an illegal currency, it was being traded in three cities in Nigeria. At the same time, the Oduwa People's Congress had issued an ultimatum to President Obasanjo that if they did not release Ganiyu Adams and Frederick Fashion, who were the leaders of that place, that they were going to bomb the Southwest and make it ungovernable. The Arawa Consultative Forum had also, at that time, issued a communique coming out of a very important meeting that if the next president of Nigeria after Obasanjo was not a northerner, the Nigerian experiment, they called it, was over. On top of all of this bad news, the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States had then said that Nigeria had less than 15 years by their scenario planning to be together before it becomes a failed state. They predicted that by 2019, Nigeria will break up into four republics, the Calabari Republic, the Arewa Republic, the Biafra Republic, and the Oduwa Republic. So with all of this knowledge in mind, when I hear God say that Nigeria will be undoubtedly the world's most desirable nation to live in, I presume that God has been so busy answering the prayers of the people in Leeds and other parts of the world that he has not really been in touch with what is going on in Nigeria. So I'm praying with him. I'm saying, amen, oh. And it was for me the amen of Sarah. It was an amen loaded with unbelief. But I heard his voice very clearly say to me, I do not pray. Who will I pray to? The second thing he said to me was, my son, I am not a prophet. I speak through prophets, but I'm not a prophet. The third thing he said to me is that your past, which is speaking to me, your past, your present, and your future are all within my present. That is why I am that I am, not I was when I used to be. Yeah. The last thing that he said to me was that when I speak to you about what will happen in 2025, I'm not telling you what I'm about to do, I'm telling you what I've already done. And at that instant, I broke down and I started to cry. I said, God, what would you have me do? And he said to me, go and build me the people that will build the nation. Build me the people that will build the nation. And since that time, this is essentially what I've been doing. In 2005, I was having a meeting with two people, and I noticed that their mouth was moving, but I couldn't hear their words. I thought for a moment that I was deaf, that I had lost my sense of hearing. And then I heard the word gemstone. And I thought to myself, what is gemstone? I heard, raise me a generation that is empowered, motivated, and stirred to operate with natural excellence. He said, that generation will lead the building of Nigeria into a most desirable nation. They will not only build their nation, they will shape their continent, and they will shape their earth positively. Ladies and gentlemen, I came here because I believe that you have been empowered. many of you here today no longer understand what it means for you to not know whether you will have power tonight. Just having power in your home is not a prayer point for many of you. No, no, I presume that many of you do not have generators. I probably suspect that none of you have a generator. I don't know whether you understand this. But the reason why you have been given this privilege is so that you can take what has now become norm and go and normalize it for others. So you are not given the privilege to only be able to go out of the country. You're supposed to go out and get a new thinking and come and impose that thinking on your country. If people from this place could change the culture of Africa, 27 of them, how many are we here? Are there not more than 27 here?
Yes.
If some people could come out and change the face of a continent, can we not change the face of a nation? This is what I believe, that you have the obligation, you have the right, you owe it to the land. Because, listen to this, if you do not fix Nigeria, then you must deal with the reality that in the midst of an impoverished lot, a privileged few are an endangered species.